Hello everyone, welcome to System Software and Compilers Module 3 lecture video. In this lecture, we will be looking at error recovery strategies, context-free grammars, and notational conventions. Error recovery strategies. Once an error is detected, how should the parser recover? Although no strategy has proven itself universally acceptable, a few methods have a broad applicability. The simplest approach is for the parser to quit with an informative error message when it detects the first error. Additional errors are often uncovered if the parser can restore itself to a state where processing of the input can continue with reasonable hopes that the further processing will provide meaningful diagnostic information. If errors pile up, it is better for the compiler to give up after exceeding some error limit than to produce spurious errors. Panic mode recovery. With this panic mode recovery method, on discovering an error, the parser discards input symbols one at a time until one of a designated set of synchronizing tokens is found. The synchronizing tokens are usually delimiters such as semicolon or curly braces, whose role in the source program is clear and unambiguous. The compiler designer must select the synchronizing tokens appropriate for the source language. While panic mode correction often skips a considerable amount of input without checking it for additional errors, it has the advantage of simplicity and unlike some methods, it is guaranteed not to go into an infinite loop. Phrase level recovery. On discovering an error, a parser may perform local correction on the remaining input. That is, it may replace a prefix of the remaining input by something that allows the parser to continue. A typical local correction is to replace a comma by a semicolon, delete an extra semicolon, or insert a missing semicolon. The choice of the local correction is left to the compiler designer. Of course, we must be careful to choose replacements that do not lead to infinite loops, as would be the case, for example, if we always inserted something on the input ahead of the current input symbol. Phrase level replacement has been used in several error repairing compilers, as it can correct any input string. Its major drawback is the difficulty it has in coping with the situations in which the actual error has occurred before the point of detection. Error productions. By anticipating common errors that might be encountered, we can augment the grammar for the language at hand with productions that generate the erroneous constructs. A parser constructed from a grammar augmented by these error productions detects the anticipated errors when an error production is used during parsing. The parser can then generate appropriate error diagnostics about the erroneous construct that has been recognized in the input. Global correction. Ideally, we would like a compiler to make as few changes as possible in processing an incorrect input string. There are algorithms for choosing a minimal sequence of changes to obtain a globally least cost correction. Given an incorrect input string X and a grammar G, these algorithms will find a parse tree for a related string Y such that the number of insertions, deletions and changes of tokens required to transform X into Y is as small as possible. Unfortunately, these methods are in general too costly to implement in terms of time and space. So these techniques are currently only of theoretical interest. Remember that a closest correct program may not be what the programmer had in his mind. Nevertheless, the notion of least cost correction provides a yardstick for evaluating error recovery techniques and has been used for finding optimal replacement strings for phrase level recovery. A grammar naturally describes the hierarchical structure of most programming language constructs. For example, an if-else statement in Java can have the form if expression statement else statement. Now that is an if-else statement is the concatenation of the keyword if and opening parenthesis and an expression and a closing parenthesis, a statement and the keyword else and another statement. Using the variable expression to denote an expression and the variable statement to denote the statement. This structuring rule can be expressed as statement statement derives if expression statement else statement, in which the arrow can be read as can have the form. This arrow can be read as can have the form. Such a rule is called a production. In a production, lexical elements like the keyword if and the parentheses are called terminals. Variables like expression and statement represent sequences of terminals and are called non-terminals. Context-free grammar consists of terminals, non-terminals, start symbol and productions. Terminals. Terminals are the basic symbols from which strings are formed. The term token name is a synonym for terminal, and we will use the word token for the terminal when it is clear that we are talking about just the token name. We assume that the terminals are the first components of the tokens. Those are output by the lexical analyzer. For example, production statement derives if expression statement else statement. The terminals in this production are the keywords if and else, and the symbols, the opening parenthesis and the closing parenthesis. Non-terminals are syntactic variables that denote sets of strings. In the previous example, the statement derives if expression statement else statement. In this production, the statement and the expressions are non-terminals. The sets of strings denoted by non-terminals help to define the language generated by the grammar. Non-terminals impose a hierarchical structure on the language that is key to syntax analysis and translation. In a grammar, one non-terminal is distinguished as a start symbol of the grammar, and the set of strings it denotes is the language generated by the grammar. Conventionally, the productions for the start symbol are listed first. The productions of a grammar specify the manner in which the terminals and non-terminals can be combined to form strings. Each production consists of a non-terminal called head or left side of the production. This production defines some of the strings denoted by the head. The symbol sometimes has been used in place of the arrow. A body of right hand side consisting of zero or more terminals and non-terminals. For the considered example, the terminals and non-terminals are present in RHS, that is the right hand side of the production, and we call this as a body of the production. The components of the body describe one way in which strings of the non-terminal at the head can be constructed. Now, let us consider the grammar that defines simple arithmetic expressions, that is, E derives E plus T, E derives E minus T, E derives T, T derives T star F, T derives T slash F, F derives parenthesized E, and F derives ID. In this grammar, the terminal symbols are plus, minus, star, opening parenthesis, and closing parenthesis. The non-terminals. Non-terminals are expression, term, and factor. Expression is E, term is T, factor is F. And the expression is the start symbol. So here the first production is E derives E plus T. In this one, the left hand side non-terminal E will be the start symbol of the grammar. Notational conventions. Terminals. The terminals can be represented using certain symbols. Those are the lowercase letters early in the alphabet, such as A, B, C, and the operator symbols, such as plus, star, slash, and so on, and the punctuation symbols, such as the parenthesis, opening parenthesis, closing parenthesis, comma, and so on. The digits representing from 0 to 9, and the strings such as ID or if each of which represents a single terminal symbol. Non-terminals are usually represented using the uppercase letters such as A, B, C, and the letter S, which is usually used as a start symbol, and it will be a non-terminal. And the lowercase italic names such as expression and statement, these can also be considered as the non-terminals. And when discussing programming constructs, the uppercase letters may be used to represent non-terminals for the constructs. For example, the non-terminals for expressions, terms, and factors are often represented by the capital letters E, T, and F.